There's sadly just a hint of déjà vu about things at the moment. Last year, we were encouraged to have ourselves a merry little Christmas. And this year, we may have harboured the idea that we would more than make up for last year's frugality and lack of partying. So this year, we started earlier than ever. Festive streetlights glistened in the dusk of late October. We received our first Christmas card in November this year. This Christmas was going to be bigger and better than ever. But like the England cricket team before a catastrophic batting collapse, all our plans, our hopes, our dreams now lie cruelly shattered and broken. But it is in the light of that that I want us to think about the themes of humility and rejoicing. You see, the unrelenting and unforgiving nature of reality can humble us. It can bring us down. We're often humbled by the things that happen to us. But the story of Christmas suggests that rather than being humbled, we should actively choose humility. That humility is a virtue, a grace, a fruit of God at work in us. And it is something that we should embrace. Elizabeth, the mother of John the Baptist, shows humility. She honours Mary, proclaiming her blessedness and says, "Why has this happened to me that the mother of my Lord comes to me?" When I was a pastoral assistant at a church in London, I was asked by the vicar to preach on Elizabeth and the visitation and how it felt to be second best. But I don't think she felt that she was second best. She, who had been humbled by her inability to conceive, was now pregnant. And here she was experiencing in her very being the joy of being with Jesus. And, of course, with Mary. Mary, who had already described herself as a servant, a handmaid, and she said to God, "Let it be to me according to your word." Mary was probably no older than 13 and is more likely to have been around 11 or 12 years old. She was humble, poor, and was probably no longer in full-time education. Mary, as the story goes, was visited by an angel who told her that she was to have a child. Paul Aguda says, "Here's a young girl who was asked by God to face disgrace in order to bring salvation into the world. She is charged with facing that disgrace and potential danger to life and limb alone, and she does it with courage and dignity." And Paula adds, "The mother in me rails at God for asking too much of a young girl. But the Christian marvels at the courage of this young girl, Mary, whose sacrifice of her own reputation and safety enabled the Word made flesh, God with us, to be born in our midst." When Mary is with Elizabeth, she bursts into song, a song that we call the Magnificat, in which Mary praises a God who turns the world upside down. In his mercy, God overthrows the proud and the powerful, rejects the wealthy and exploitative, and raises up the poor and the marginalized. Her song is a song of justice. It's a song that declares God's blessing upon the humble and meek, and Jesus' own birth followed through on that theme. Maybe it is only when we face the crude, almost offensive reality of Christmas that we can begin to see what it was that God was trying to say about himself. Jesus coming to earth was like no other royal visit. His wasn't a mass-publicised, beautifully orchestrated, multi-million-pound trip, but an obscure, chaotic, impoverished birth, and yet a birth that reveals so much about the God who came to earth, a God who is humble. Before the time of Jesus, no pagan author had ever used the word humble as a compliment. And yet Jesus shows us the humility of God, the maker of all things, things immeasurable, mighty and great, became a single fertilized ovum which divided and redivided, developing into a fetus which grew inside a nervous teenager. John Donne described it as immensity cloistered in thy dear womb. The writer Philip Yancey wrote in his book about Jesus that the God who roared, who could order armies and empires about like pawns on a chessboard, this God emerged in Palestine as a baby who could not speak or eat solid food or control his bladder, who depended on a teenage couple for shelter, food and love. Maybe this year, more than any other, we need to hear this aspect of the Christmas message, that God's blessing is upon the humble and meek, that God himself chose simplicity over extravagance, poverty over wealth, humility over a sense of entitlement. The Son of God chose a life of simplicity, and his example remains with us. But this call to humility does not condemn us to a mean and miserable existence. For what we're presented with is humility and joy. In Luke's account of the visit of Mary to Elizabeth, rejoicing is a central theme. John the Baptist, while still in his mother's womb, leapt for joy because he knew that he was in the presence of the Messiah, even though the Messiah himself had yet to be born. Elizabeth says to Mary, "How happy, how blessed are you among women." And Mary herself says, "My spirit rejoices in God my Saviour." Rejoicing runs through today's gospel reading. And what fueled all that rejoicing was the sense that at last God had kept his promise and he'd sent a Messiah, a deliverer. And whatever troubles us, whatever worries we might have, whatever sadness we may carry in our hearts, the birth of that baby makes a difference. And it makes a difference even now. God has come into this world, not as judge, not to condemn it, but as a saviour in order to liberate it and fill it with his joy. The angels said they came with good news of great joy. And when the shepherds heeded their message and went to see Jesus, they returned glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen. The whole of the Christmas story is about rejoicing. And I think we need to rediscover something of that. I think we need to move from humbug to hallelujah. We need to hear again the good news of our salvation. That's not to say that things aren't tough, and I think particularly for the bereaved, Christmas can be a very painful time. But there's something in the Christmas message of salvation and hope that is the fulfillment of what Isaiah spoke of when he said that the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion, singing, and everlasting joy will be upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Everlasting joy. Not happiness, which we may feel for 1 minute, then lose the next. Not a momentary feeling, but an eternal, unending state of bliss, a heavenly gift, something that cannot be bought, manufactured, inherited, or stolen. Everlasting joy. Now I know that we will not fully come into that state of everlasting joy until God's saving purposes have been completely fulfilled. And the whole creation is reconciled to God in Christ. But Christmas looks forward to and anticipates that joy. We are those who anticipate everlasting joy. Christmas is then a foretaste of that joy, a time for mirthful singing, for caroling, for laughter that befits those who are free, and joy deep down in our hearts and worn as a crown, as a visible, attractive, shining glory. That's what Isaiah means when he says that everlasting joy shall be upon our heads. It's a crown that we wear. So we must try not to let the disappointment and frustration of this Christmas stop us from rejoicing. And there will be things to do, many things to do, but it'll be great. So let's not let the busyness either deprive us of the opportunity to rejoice. Let's remember the awesome truth woven into the mystery of Christmas. And like the shepherds and kings of old, let's bow down in humility and worship. For this is our God. So may our humility and disappointment and frustration become the cradle into which Jesus can be born once more, to heal us and transform us, and to love us from within, and to give us joy. Things are tough, and this Christmas may not be everything that we had planned. I'm really sorry. But let us discover in the midst of all that is going on something of the humble joy that is God's gift to us. Amen.